probably, I think there's a lot of parallels between, you know, ketone bodies and ketone supplements and how they're not only being used as a preferential source of energy in the brain. Do you know anything about this? About like how it frees up glucose then to be used for other metabolic pathways? Yeah, glucose
sparing. Yeah, it's thought that some of the work by Stephen Kunane, I think, is shedding light on this too. If you,
where's he at?
He's in Canada. I forget the institute that he's at. Joe LaManna has done some similar work, and he's at Case Western, and looked at the kind of the interaction of what does the brain prefer as what's the preferred fuel source for the brain. I get this question a lot. I think it depends on, you know, I don't know if it's right to say that the brain always prefers
the brain
ketones.
Cell we're talking about.
Yeah,
the, one.
The brain. Yeah, neurons and astrocytes. But yeah, I guess, I mean, maybe we're definitely biased towards understanding neurons relative to astrocytes.
I think most people ask you that question.
Astrocytes are fascinating. I think we need to study that more. But I think in the context of like aging, in the context of traumatic brain injury or pathology, I think the brain will really prefer to use ketones because, or in the context of some kind of stress, you know, hypoglycemia or something like that, I think the brain will also prefer to use ketones.
Yeah. So why do you think that is?
Well, I think
I have my own
reasons
why.
There's a whole host of reasons that or things that can cause impaired brain energy, brain glucose metabolism, and that could be internalization of the GLUT3 transporter, which occurs. It's kind of linked to Alzheimer's pathology.
GLUT3,
yeah, and there's a couple key enzymes that are either deficient or not active like they should be. Pyruvate dehydrogenase complex is deficient in. Like,
so wait, are these in? Are the GLUT3 changes in astrocytes or in neurons?
Primarily in neurons.
Neurons.
Yeah.
Okay.
So the glucose transporter in neurons is not.
But so if neurons are using lactate primarily, the astrocytes are actually. What's
shuttling the lactate?
Shuttling. The astrocytes are using glucose, and that's why the brain needs glucose.
Yep.
And they're producing the lactate.
Yep.
The neurons are using the lactate because it's, you know, getting shunted in and converted into pyruvate. Yeah.
And the contribution of that is not completely known, but it's pretty significant contribution during hypoxia, I would think.
There's been studies out there showing that not just during hypoxia, but actually just under normal physiology,
it's a key player.
It is. Yeah, the neurons are getting lactate continually from astrocytes, which are generating it, but that the astrocytes become aberrant during, for whatever reason, it's not known, Alzheimer's disease, traumatic brain injury.
Yeah.
So they can't make that lactate, and neurons have to start using the glucose. Which then is, but I mean, that's just one.
Yeah, I've heard about that. I haven't looked into that. Yeah, so there's some key enzymes in that people look at, not only just the lactate levels. Yeah.
I think that, I have no idea what they're looking at, but for the pyruvate dehydrogenase complex, you're saying that's also aberrant in some of these disease states, because then you wouldn't be able to use the lactate because you can convert it into pyruvate.
Yeah.
So anyways. Yeah. It's all kind of, I totally interrupted you though, but you were talking about, what were you talking about? The aberrant enzymes like GLUT3 and pyruvate dehydrogenase and how these are, aberrant in different neurological disorders.
Yeah.
Okay. Sorry.
I think, well, maybe the question that we're trying to get at is the contribution of ketones as a brain energy source, you know, and especially in sort of, in academia and circles where I teach, it's not even still not really known as not, it's not really accepted or understood that much. But I think the capacity, the metabolic flexibility of the brain to be able to use ketones, we can exploit that, you know, and that's, we do that with nutritional ketosis and it's altering brain energy metabolism and the neuropharmacology of the brain in ways we don't completely understand now, meaning the neurotransmitters in the brain. So I could draw off GABA. So you have more GABA. The GABA to glutamate ratio is shifted in favor of higher GABA. So there's a higher GABA to glutamate ratio when one is on the ketogenic diet. And
in people that are not, you know, having normal people as well? Just like in general?
Yeah, it's thought that, and there's different reasons for that. There's glutamic acid decarboxylase is an enzyme.
Is that how it helps with epilepsy?
That's part of it. I think there's about 20 or more things going on really, if you look at all the signaling pathways,
as does everything in
what happens with metabolism. But I think a key player in that is an elevation of GABA to glutamate, and we need glutamate to make GABA, right? But the enzyme is elevated, and the pathways are shift in favor of more glutamate to GABA, which has a stabilizing effect on your cell membrane and neuronal activity in general.
How readily do ketones cross the blood-brain barrier? Is it?
It's thought, up to 5 millimolar, maybe 6-7 millimolar, they can readily cross the blood-brain barrier.
You have to get that high before they start crossing?
No, you start impeding.
Okay.
Yeah,
I see.
Once you get levels up that high, and it hasn't really been studied, in depth. We did brain metabolomics to show that. When we looked at the ketone levels in brain tissue and ketone levels in the blood, and there's a high correlation there. Interestingly, we had a diet too that was high in medium chain fatty acids, and although I heard medium chain fatty acids could readily cross the blood-brain barrier, long chain fatty acids typically don't, short chain fatty acids sort of do, but we found very high levels of medium chain fatty acids, indicative of them. And these were normal, healthy animals. So when you take medium-chain fatty acids, they are readily, from the looks of our metabolomic data, just readily crossing the blood-brain barrier and capable of being used as fuel.
That's fascinating.
So it's really interesting. I heard about that, but when you see the data,
levels. The brain, then how are they? So then what happens? Mm-hmm. So they're used.
Yeah, their medium chain fatty acids can be oxidized
just
fatty acids
okay.
for fuel. Yeah.
Interesting. Uh-huh.